Hello everyone, welcome to the joint webinar, Get Started with Android 10 on NXP i.MX 8 and i.MX 8X application processors, presented by Toradex and our guest and partner Kynetics. My name is Leonardo Veiga, and today I am with Nicola LaGloria, CEO from Kynetics, and Roberto Sartori, embedded software engineer from Kynetics. Before we begin, I would like to give you a few tips so that you take the best out of this presentation. On the webinar tool, there is a chat window where you can let us know if you face any technical issues, such as bad audio experience or video does not showing up. And there is also a field for submitting questions. Please do submit the questions anytime you want throughout the webinar, because at the end of the presentation, we will have a live Q&A session where we will answer those. The presentation will be recorded and available 1 week after on demand on the Toradex website. Before we begin to talk about Android, I'd like to say a few words about Toradex. For those of you who don't know Toradex, we are ARM-based computer and module manufacturer, and our main goal is to make embedded computing easy for our customers. And by making embedded computing easy, we allow you to have the lowest cost of ownership and thus a successful project and competitive project. And to make that possible, we also believe that support is very, very important. And this is why we strive to provide industry-leading support to you, so you take your product as fast as possible with the lowest time to market possible. Toradex has a global presence with offices in the USA and also in Switzerland, where is our headquarters, and other offices across the globe. Our products are the computer modules, and they are divided in three families. The first one is Apalis. This is the slightly bigger form factor than the other two families, and it's the high-end family. For instance, we have Apalis MX8 featuring NXP i.MX8 processor, which is a very powerful SoC. The Apalis family also has the high-speed interfaces such as USB 3.0, PCI Express, Gigabit Ethernet, and others. There is also the Calibri family, which is the oldest of our families. So it's very mature and proven in the field by thousands of customers, literally. And this is the family where you find the low-end SoCs, and therefore the computer modules with a very low power consumption and also a good cost to performance ratio. So they are very cost efficient as well. When it comes to performance, there is a bit overlap between Apalis and Calibri families. And since Calibri, it's been around for quite some time now, we have identified that there are some new and exciting hardware interfaces that we would like to provide to you. And this is why we've introduced Verding at the beginning of this year. And Verding is a family of computer modules that is aiming at providing the hardware interfaces for the future, such as MIPI DSI for display, MIPI CSI 2 for camera, and we use, for instance, 1.8 voltage for I/O and a wide range power supply so that you can use a single cell battery to power up the computer module, among several other benefits. On the software side, we have Torizon, an easy-to-use industrial Linux platform. We have the traditional embedded Linux based on Yocto. and Windows CE. Those are in-house operating systems, and you can also run free RTOS or, for instance, Android, which is provided by our partner Kynetics. Our typical applications where our customers are inserted, they are the industrial automation and healthcare markets, but also transportation, test and measurement, and smart cities. And the annual volumes range from 100 to 50,000 pieces a year. Now, beginning to talk about Android, and before handing over to Kynetics, I would like to say a few words about Android on Toradex modules and show you where you can find more information. And then I'm going to bring up the Toradex website here, just drag my browser. And basically, when you navigate to toradex.com, you can go to the products tab and you'll find the Android logo under software. This is a nice page because it provides you an overview of Android on Toradex, including the advantages about why should I run Android on Toradex computer modules. And just to name a few here, I'm not going through everything on the page, but a very strong and nice thing about Toradex is that you can evaluate Android with one click. So you buy the hardware, unbox it, plug an Ethernet cable, hook up an HDMI display, and you simply select Kynetics Android with one click, and you have it installed in a few minutes without needing to download anything on your computer or creating and flashing SD cards and all that stuff. And we provide Android BSPs for evaluation, both in source code format, which is free, and as binary images. And our Android offerings are provided by partners. Kynetics is our preferred partner and preferred Android integrator, and they provide Android BSPs for our i.MX8 modules and also i.MX7 and i.MX6 based modules. Then after you understand the overview, you want to actually try that in practice. And that's very easy because we have the developer website where you can find everything about our Android offerings, such as how to quick start, the supported products, and several details about the Kynetics Android offerings, where to find the source code and much more. And the quick start is a very nice page because here we provide to you a step-by-step on how to get started. Therefore, in a few minutes, you can build and deploy your own sample to the board and evaluate it. And there are also a few words about Update Factory from Kynetics, and I'll let Nicola and Roberto cover that later for you in more details during the webinar. With that being said, that's all on my side. And now I would like to hand over to Nicola LaGloria from Kynetics.
Hello, everyone. This is Nicola from Kynetics. With me, I have Roberto Sartori, that is a lead Android engineer. And today we will be talking about our Android 10 for the Toradex i.MX 8 family of processors. So the agenda for today, a little bit about Kynetics, and then we will switch on our Kynetics evaluation BSP for all the Toradex products that we support. And then we will explore other related products, Android-related products that we offer. Finally, we will switch on Xamarin and Visual Studio. That is an interesting topic for who wants to switch from Windows to Android. It's a good primer for using the same IDE and development environment for developing Android applications. Then we will talk about Android 10 features and then our Android 10 evaluation BSP for the i.MX QM. The final topic is a kind of very interesting one, and it regards the difference between development and production OSs. Android is a great operating system for developing a production-ready and secure OS, and also provide a very agile and flexible development OS for developing and debugging options. So about us, Kynetics is a company based in California and Europe. We are an engineering-driven company, and so primarily we focus on engineering communities and projects in the open source community. We are members of the Eclipse Foundation. In particular, we are members of the IoT Working Group and the H-Netting Working Group. And in particular, we are member also of the steering committees of the H-Netting Working Group. We are maintainers of the project ARA, that is an embedded client for the Eclipse Hawkbit, a remote update and provisioning system released open source under the Eclipse umbrella by Bosch. The client is already an open source project even before joining the Eclipse Foundation, and we will get to some details during the presentation. You can see there the GitHub anyway on the presentation. So yeah, you will have all these links at the end, by the way. We are committers of different other projects outside also the Android space. In particular, we are committers on the SW update, that is an OTA client for Linux. Committers on the Yocto project. Of course, we have some Linux kernel patches and also U-Boot. Talking about our value proposition in terms of VSP for the Toradex products, we support different SO modules and carrier boards. I really suggest you to take a look at our website, in particular on the section products Android VSPs, and you can find what we offer for the Toradex line of products. Here you can see the entire list. You can navigate and see, you know, what is the target platform that you are interested in. Some of those include sources. Some of those include just the binary distribution. So going back, you will see that supported products differ from the silicon revision, and we will see in detail what it means. And of course, some revision dependencies, carrier board dependencies, and of course, we, as I said, there are binaries and sources available. One important source of documentation is our technical notes, that is our technical blog. You go into the about, write technical notes, or you go into the homepage and you will find the link to the technical notes. Here you can browse like a lot of articles we have been writing in the past 3 years. And in particular, you will find, like in the case of the Android 10 on the i.MX 8 QM, all the documentation for flashing the image and everything that you need to know about the distribution and the BSP. All right, so of course, we support Easy Installer as a first flash procedure. As Leonardo told you, it's really easy to deploy one of our BSP thanks to Easy Installer. And one thing that is included in our binary images are also some add-ons like the update factory that is gives you the chance to explore the features of an OTA remote update system for apps and the entire operating system, so it works for both. And what we call the Android SDK extension apps. So we will see what an Android SDK extension is, and the apps are a great tool for evaluating what those extensions can do. I think there is like a poll right now, just to make this presentation a little bit more interactive. So is your company considering an Android as an option for your embedded product? Of course, it's yes, no, or not yet. So it's just to understand also the type of audience we have today. And so it would be interesting to know what is the feedback on this. Oh, good. Really good. So let's move forward. Android-related products. So what we offer, except other than the Android evaluation DSPs, we do offer other products related to the Android world. In particular, we have the SDK extensions. So what SDK extensions are, let's go back again on our websites and you go to products, SDK extensions. And in really few words, Android extensions are a library that can be included into your Android Studio or Xamarin project, and it gives you access to SDK that are not natively provided by Android. Let's say that you want to access from API, your canvas, so GPIOs, serial, SPI, and PWM, right? These are not supported natively by Android, so we made that available to your development environment. We license these products. If you have any question, you are really free to contact us, and we will be absolutely happy to give you more details. Let's switch back to the presentation. Another interesting product is Update Factory, that is an OTA management and provisioning system. Works great for OS updates. It works great for app packages updates, especially for who does not have access to the Google Play Store, because you don't have GMS certification. You need a way to distribute your apps around remote devices. Update Factory, you want to surely take a look at that and see if it can make your use case more easy. Another thing that we offer, we call it Vibe. Vibe is, as you may know, Android is a really huge, it's an operating system that has a really huge number of repositories, right? More than 200. And so if we have to deliver sources to a customer, or some customers buys a BSP code from us, we want an handy way to deliver sources in order for the customers to build that right away. And Vibe is an AWS bundle that provides building tools and source code into one delivery. So basically you have the building system already set up, you have the sources attached, already built once. So what we deliver is actually working. And you can take control and import that into your virtual private cloud. Of course, we can provide sources in the more legacy way. That means that we can push code into remote repositories or provide patches. But Vibe is really handy if you want something up and running in the shortest time frame. The last product that is not, we didn't advertise so much, but it's something that we have been working for a long time, is called what we call Cohesis OS. Is an Android OS that features asymmetric multiprocessing. And talking about that, we have an interesting article that you can take a look at. So let me go back to the homepage and go to the technical notes. I think that we have already here something, right? So here, no. There you go. So this is a technical notes from 2018. So here we have an Android app that displays data coming from an IMU, an inertial sensor that is attached to the M4. So the M4 is doing the data reading and processing, pass those data to the i.MX7, and the Android app is just showing a nice UI and displaying the data. Here you can find, you know, the entire architecture. So based on this, we created an operating system that is ready to host your AMP application. We call that Cohesis OS. So we give the free RTOS, and all the demo can be available upon request. I think that we have another poll here, actually. So does your company have an in-house skills for customizing Android OS? This is something that we ask to customers all the time. So we appreciate if the customers has competence on Android. And so it's also the conversation is more easy, because as you know, as many of you knows, you know, Android is a sort of different kind of operating system with respect to Linux. So it's very important to, okay, so here we have basic level and done. So this is, you know, we will we would be going through some basic stuff and also something for people that are not really aware of how Android works. So thanks for saying that, for giving us the chance. So Xamarin, let's talk about Xamarin, right? So Xamarin is a sort of a runtime environment that allows you to compile code from your Visual Studio and run it on an Android platform. We have seen customers switching from Windows CE that is ending, the support is ending soon, right? Moving to Android, of course, there is a little bit of gap to fill, like understands the Android API. However, Xamarin has been pretty effective, because as a short time to market, it's native UI, so it's something that is performant, 100% API access. Of course, you have some runtime overhead, but again, it seems to be like a really nice way to switch from Windows to a different OS, right? And what we can add to that is that our SDK extensions actually support Visual Studio. So we have libraries that can be included in your Visual Studio project to have available those API that are not natively available on the Android SDKs. So again, if you want to control GPIOs, if you want to control PWM, canvas, serial ports, and such. I think there is another pool here. And the poll here is more about if you guys are using Xamarin or like Android standard Android Studio IDE development. So are you a Visual Studio or an Android Studio kind of developer or neither, right? So let's see what. Okay, so most of you guys uses the standard way, like Android Studio. You know that right now, Google switched more to Kotlin as a primary programming language than Java. We switched too, so I hope that you guys did the same. Kotlin is really a great language, you know, that speed up development quite a little bit more than Java. So I will pass the mic right now to Roberto that will talk about more about Android 10 and what our Android 10 looks like on the i.MX 8 family of processors.
Hi all, I'm Roberto from Kynetics. As Nicole anticipated, I'm now going to show a bit more about the Android 10 requirements and features of our VSPs. So we've listed here a couple of requirements that are related to the quantity of RAM and the size of the EMC. Those two requirements are related also to the new features available on Android 10. For example, like on all Android major releases, there are a lot of new services that are provided by Google. In particular, we have listed here scoped storage that allows the user, the developers, to give the application some granularity on the file control on the file system. There are, of course, low-level innovation like the device tree, a blob object that is a new partition that allows us to support different hardware using the same Android images. You can find an example on our Android 10 image for the Apalis i.MX 8 because we support both the Apalis 1.0 and 1.1 using the same Android image. On Android 10, we also support the new super partition. We will see the detail later, but basically the super partition allows us to repartition the Android user space during over-the-air update. You can resize partition, even delete or add partition. There are also features that were available in Android 9, but were improved in Android 10, like TrustOS. TrustOS allows you to run your application in a trusted environment. Of course, this is mostly for production OS, like we will see later, and not in evaluation BSP. On Android 10, Google also introduced the new Apex packages that are basically core system packages that allows Google to update this core system without the need to update all the Android image. Here are more details about our Android 10 release for the Apalis i.MX 8. We support from actually yesterday the sum 1.1 and 1.0, like we can see on our website. Let me find, so we can go into our home page, our Android BSP, our Toradex. This is our latest release supporting the SOM 1.1. This is a binary image. You can find the extraction of our technical notes. The sources are not available yet, but they will be available soon. We also plan to make available an Android 10 release for the Colibri i.MX 8. You can, of course, find the sources for all the releases of our BSP supporting the Apalis SOM. These are more details like kernel bootloader version, kernel 5.4 Ubuntu 2020. We also support Treble. Treble is this mechanism that is provided by Google that basically allows to update the Android operating system without the need to change the kernel at the bootloader version. Google actually provides a generic system image that you can download from a Google service and try to flash on even over our BSP. So if you want to try like Android 11, you can just do that. In our Android 10 BSP, we provide a demo application that includes our SDK extension libraries. These are the list, like Nicola mentioned earlier, of our demo application. Those are in binary form in our BSP, but you can find on our GitHub, so github.com/kinetics. You can find the source code of the application, for example, the GPIO example application. So you can look how you should interact with our library that is not provided in this repository. Of course, also Update Factory client is included in all our BSP releases. You can actually get one month free account from our website, and you can also check all the documentation. You can find under products at factory. These are the introduction, then there are also the configuration documentation. Like I said, this is the BSP available on our website are only for evaluative purposes, so there are no security features enabled like Trusty or DM Verity. Now we have a video that Leonardo have prepared about that we show the installation process a bit more about Update Factory and the SDK extension. So we now launch the video and Leonardo will take over.
And we begin this video showing the Toradex Easy Installer user interface. I have recorded it directly from the video output of the board. And with one click, you select and install it. And after a few minutes, then it will prompt you to reboot the board and you will see Android running. And that's as simple as that. Assemble the hardware, select Kynetics Android, and wait a few minutes until it downloads everything. Then I have it running here on a 10-inch LVDS display with capacitive touch. And as you can see, it already works. I also have an antenna for Wi-Fi there. I will not connect to the interface, but show the scan. You can also have a quick look at the settings and confirm the information that Roberto just told us about kernel version, Android version, things like that. And what's very nice, in my opinion, are the sample applications to test hardware interfaces with the extended SDK that Kynetics provides. They're very cool and they provide a very simple, straightforward way to evaluate them. And now quickly show a little bit about Update Factory here. Nothing fancy, something just very simple. I will create a software package that does an OS update. I've actually downloaded a sample software package from the Kynetics website on their section about Update Factory. And once it's uploaded, we can actually create a distribution with one or more software modules that we will deploy to the hardware. And we attribute the software package to that distribution. And on the deployment tab, I already have a device registered. You could have a fleet here. You could manage updates and send them to the fleet or use filters or, you know, many other things. And then we select a soft update. So the device will issue a message asking you if you can download and install it. Then it asks for authorization and you select the update. Of course, you could send a forced update that would need no manual intervention as well.
Thank you, Ronaldo. That was a great video showing a bit of everything we have listed here. So we can continue. Okay, this is an important slide because it shows the complexity and the functionality of the Android partitioning system. So you can see how many partitions there are on a dual copy Android device. So we have copy A, copy B, and the new super partition introduced with Android 10. Basically, the super partition includes the user space Android partition like system, product, and vendor, and allows to resize or delete those partitions during over-the-air update. During those updates, only one of the two copies of the partition are touched, so you have always a system running correctly on your board. I will now let Nicola continue from this.
All right. Yes, again, I want to just remark the complexity of the partitioning on an Android system. And by the way, it's not unique. You can be surprised if you buy an off-the-shelf tablet that you can unlock, that those partition schema can change. This is what we got from the NXP vanilla BSP as a reference. So again, every vendor may implement this partition schema a little bit differently from others. So what I want to introduce now is the topic that I anticipated before, that is the differences between development and our production system. I call this slide Android security. It's not really about security, but the security is what right can introduce the topic of having a production ready image for your device. So a primary concept between development and production builds is given by the Android build system. So we have three different way of building Android. The first one is the more permissive one that is called user eng. User eng basically give you ADB, that is your debug interface that you are familiar with, already enabled by default. A way of doing debug as a root user. So you have ADB root command that give you the chance to shell into the Android device as a root user. The user debug is a little bit different, but not so much. So you have ADB enabled by default, but you don't have a way to become a root user. And finally, and that is more common on all your consumer product that features Android, you have a user debug that provide ADB just as a developer option. So you have to actually activate your developer options by, you know, clicking five times on the Android build version and enable ADB. Of course, there is no way on a user build to have root access to the device. So it's just sort of like really basic difference between what you can do from a simple command, from a launch configuration, right, in your build system. Of course, you can do some tweaks for making your production or, you know, your Android system a little bit more secure or siloed, as we say in production. There are many things that you can do, and we are just numbering few of them right here. Like you can disable a bootloader, screen console outputs, or timeout, right? So your bootloader doesn't wait anymore 5-3 seconds before launching the kernel. You can remove input devices, USB input devices like keyboards or mouse from the system. You can disable kernel logs, right? You can, and if you disable your serial, it's a console port, you don't have, of course, any kernel logs showing up on your host computer. When the Android is loaded, of course, you can remove Android notification bar and navigation bar. So you don't have any more those soft keys or virtual keys to navigate and exit the application, even if it is the application starts in full screen. So the point is, you can have a full kiosk mode in your final product, right? And you want to limit the interaction between the system that is running right behind the scene and your app that is in front of the user. What you can do if you have more than one app is, for instance, to develop your own custom launcher, and your custom launcher can feature other security features. Again, for instance, you want to, let's say that your device is not connected to the internet and you want to provide a way of updating the OS through a USB thumb drive, you can design your launcher to have a special pin or a special gesture to access maintenance mode. And in the maintenance mode, you may develop your own interaction with the user for handling a USB update, right? So the user insert a USB thumb drive and you copy the OTA into your local device and so on. So you can really do a lot of things. In particular, the Android settings, right? You don't want to rewrite the settings, even if you have a lot of API that allows you to control the Wi-Fi, the Bluetooth and such. The Android setting is a pretty large chunk of code, so you want to leverage what Google did for you already. But you want to distill a little bit what the user can access in terms of settings. You can call the settings as an intent, right? And so call particular subsection of the settings and limit access to other settings functionalities. And you don't want actually the user to go into those type of settings. And again, you can shop for a lot of things. You can shop for a lot of features. And again, it's a sort of use case driven type of design. So you got to know what your application is entitled to do, what the user is entitled to do, and you want to close out the other functionalities. There are a lot of things that Android can do, and a lot of settings that you may have access using different key combination, right? Like the power key for a certain number of seconds. You can take a screenshot. You can go from the Android settings through the volume up and down menu. So we have a lot of way of accessing the settings. So you need to understand exactly the user interaction with your system. But finally, what a secure or production ready OS should do is to feature some of those great announcements that Android has introduced in the past few years, starting from Android 7. Again, we are not a security expert, but we do know Android pretty well. So if the customer knows exactly which level of security he wants, we may advise the customers along. We understand if it is possible, if Android supports those type of features. So I'm here listing four of them that are really important, right, in a production environment. First of all, we start from the ground, right? So the bootloader, you guys probably know the i.Insurance boot. That means that the bootloader is signed and the key is stored, the public key is stored on the boot ROM, the fuse of the SoC. And so no bootloader can be tampered or changed because you have to sign with the key that is into the SoC and the private is just on your safe, right? So there is no way someone else can replace the bootloader. Then we can prevent, we can lock or unlock the bootloader. And so if we lock the bootloader, there is no way the user can enter in fast boot mode that allows you to flash images basically on the system. So you cannot replace the boot image or the vendor image or the system image. Then Android Verified Boot is what really makes the difference. It's a great framework. We are not going into the details of this. I think that we will do a webinar just about the Android Verified Boot. But what it does is basically signed in a sort of chain of trust, the boot image and the vendor image that contain all your native code, right? So everything that is tied to the hardware, and also the system image. So nobody can replace those images in your production system. There is more, Google introduced as DM Verity, that is also something that is available on the Linux kernel. So for Linux systems, it's a hashing system to prevent any tampering of the system image, even by replacing few bytes. So if you wanna, if you change few bytes inside the system image, the system may not decide to boot that system image because it doesn't recognize that system image as the original one. Finally, another thing that is available on general Linux system is the SC Linux, that is a kernel security module for access control. Generally, in a production system, you want to set that in enforced mode, but you gotta be aware that you gotta write a lot of rules to open resources to your applications. So again, you have to tune the system upon your application that requires resources, let's say devices on the sysfile system. You want to read a sensor, right? And for reading a sensor, you access a sysfile system because the driver is publishing there a value of a particular sensor, let's say a temperature sensor, and you have that number stored in your sysfile system. If you don't have a proper SC Linux rule in your production system, there is no way your application can access that number. So again, most of the time is a trial and error type of task, because you may, forget something, or you believe that you open all the permission required, but instead you missed a couple of one. And so looking at the logs and what the kernel is actually blocking, you can find the right new rules that you have to add to your list to allow that particular use case. So again, these are great enhancements that Android introduced. And I know that many of us have probably chosen Android in the past for the great UI, for the great framework for multimedia. But right now, security is a pretty much interesting and mature topic for Android. And again, because it runs on commercial devices, Google did a lot to offer what needs to be done or done in the right way in a production system to secure your device. So just to summarize, in Android in development, right, you want security features disabled, like DM Verity disabled, SC Linux in permissive mode, unlock bootloader, right? You want a fast boot enable and flash and replace images, and Android Verified Boot disabled, so you don't have a chain of trust starting from the boot image, so the kernel, going through the user space, and so the system image. You want all debugging options as possible. You want a serial port access. You want ADB enabled by default, and you want you want ADB as a root. So you want to login. You do an ADB root and ADB shell, and you want to be root on the device. So basically, no restrictions on accessing a particular device from the user space, like GPIOs, a serial port, and such. Instead, in a production system, you wanted to take care about, some aspects to make your device more secure, like enforcing SC Linux, ADB can be disabled or removed at all. You can also decide with a little bit of work to remove ADB and not having that available, even if you access the developer options. So you don't want that in place anymore, removed from the system. You want to lock the bootloader. You want to restrict resources to just what is needed to your application. So GPIOs, those GPIOs, or SPI devices, exactly those SPI devices, or E2C devices, just those E2C devices. Again, Android Verify Booth is a way to have a chain of trust. You can have a full chain of trust also if you introduce the high insurance booth. So you want also to secure the bootloader, signing the bootloader. And so you switch to what is called a full siloed system. So taking care about all those details for allowed your users to just interact with the features that your app is making available. No way for the user to do something that was not expected. One great tool would be to create custom launchers. So custom launchers are what can make a lot of this work really controlled, even if your application crashes, right? If your application crashes, you need a fallback. And a custom launchers can be a good fallback to create like a siloed environment from where you can just reboot the device. I think we have another poll right now for to understand if you guys, you know, consider those differences, not in an Android in general, even if you guys work with Linux, but having be aware of the differences between a production and development system is something that needs to be really, we should be aware of. So do you consider the difference between development and production OS in your current product? Yes, great. So this is absolutely what I was looking for. Okay, these are useful links. Our website, and then our GitHub again. There are a lot of resources there that we released open source. One of those are the SDK example apps. You know, there is nothing more than code to understand how an interface works. So I guess that we can write, you know, yes, a 4-page manual, but if you have some code, a real app that is using the SDK extension, you know exactly how it works. Technical notes, again, is a real good way of being in touch with what we do, and documentation. Android, Toradex Android DSP page. So you have all the list of what we offer in terms of binaries and sources for the Toradex line of products. And finally, the update factory OTA management, right? So feel free to contact us if you have any question about that. That said, it's thanks for your attention. I think we have time for questions right now. So let's dig into it.
Yes. Thank you, Nicola and Roberto. And now I'd like to ask the audience if you have any last minute questions, those who haven't submitted during the presentation, now is a very good time. And meanwhile, let me fetch here some questions. The first one here is, I have downloaded and tried the evaluation BSP for my target platform. What is the next step? And this one I think is good for Kynetics to answer.
So yeah, definitely if you are an Android developer, a platform developer, you can download the binary or the sources for the platform that is available. We publish the sources, build your own BSP, do experiment in the way you want, and if you feel confident that you can handle it, you know you just have what you need. If you need support, we offer professional support on our line of products. If you need and Kynetics to engage with your company to develop the foundation of your operating system, then you take over, you can do as well. We have a very flexible business model. So feel free again to contact us. So you have both options, go on your own or ask for our services, and we'll be really, really happy to help.
Okay, thanks. Next question here is, are you supporting battery management?
Oh, hi, Alfonso. So battery management is doing through the battery service. And so it's a really general question yours. So we, of course, we can customize the battery management in the way Android has been designed to, right? If there are other exotic way to do battery management, has to be explored more in detail. But for all the, we did battery power devices, yes. And we were able to give all the notification to the different system subsystems that needs to know about the battery level. And so I guess the answer is yes.
Okay, thanks. Next question is, when will be Android 10 BSP available for the Colibri MX8 Quad X Plus?
Well, I would say right now,
the new module.
Yeah, I see Daniel Martinez. So I think that it will be available in 3 weeks. You know, in 3 weeks we should have the same assets that we are releasing right now for the QM, also for the QXP.
Thanks, Nicola. Let's see here another one. Does Kynetics offer consulting services for app development on the target embedded system?
So of course, we know Android really well. My experience says that many customers come that they have already their application figured out, that they know they have already Android development capabilities in-house, but they want to have the right OSs for running their app. And this is where we have our big value. Of course, we, for instance, we talk about custom launchers. Custom launchers is what we do as a special application, right, to announce other application to be launched from the custom launcher. So definitely we can do advice on application development. We can offer custom launchers or at least good advice on how to develop a secure custom launcher. Again, security is driven by use case from customers, right? Because again, you can do a lot of things. There are a lot of things that you can be aware of or not. You just need to have a clear idea what your goal is. So definitely we can advise on, you know, from an application perspective to make that happen.
Okay, thanks. Another one here is a generic question. Please, can you speak on running Android on the NXP hypervisor?
Well, this is something that we do not support. There are other products out there, other providers that offers a way to run Android on an hypervisor, inside an hypervisor, so you have different operating systems segregated, by the way. This is what the virtualization actually offer. We are not at the moment supporting any hypervisor integration, right? So I don't know what means NXP hypervisor in particular. We know that our proprietary hypervisors, right? We know that there are the open source project for virtualization that we tried, but well, I don't recall right now, but there is something that is released as open source. It's not NXP, it's an open source project that is Xen, I guess it's Xen, X-E-N. And I know that many solutions leverage Xen to run also Android. So, you know, you for sure you wanna take a look at that. What we are doing right now, actually, that's pretty interesting, talking about segregation, we are working on Android that supports Docker, so dots, containers. So that is pretty cool because it gives us the ability to explore a new deployment model. And we actually have a prototype working. So, you know, it's another type of segregation. It's not like, you know, like enable an hypervisor, but still has a great value. Are running on Android and support Docker containers will open a lot of other different possibilities.
Yeah, that's nice. And depending if you want something real time test, there is your Cohesis OS also, right?
Cortex-M
runs on other OS or bare metal or.
Yeah, you can run FreeRTOS, and so and again, i.MX8 is a asymmetric multiprocessor, so it's you can run on multi-core, and that is a great way of enabling segregation between two different environments. And again, if you take a look at what we have done with Coesis, the MX7, we have already images that can be delivered to customers to try out. Absolutely, that is another way of implementing segregation between two different OSs and leave the M4 do some real-time job that Android cannot do, but Android can do his job to display nice interfaces.
Okay. We have no other questions. Therefore, I would like to thank the audience for staying with us. And I would like to especially thank you, Nicola and Roberto, for being here with us today.
Thanks to all of you. Thanks to Toradex. Thanks, Leonardo, for having done that great demo, that video. Lakshmi, for handling our operation behind the scene, for making this webinar possible, and all the audience that actually join and tune in for this webinar.
And as a reminder, this webinar is being recorded and will be available in a week time from now. Thanks very much, everyone. Have a nice day.
Bye, all.
Bye.